Hey folks, if you're coming in, we're just going to give it a few minutes. You can see a note from Sarah in the chat saying the same thing. I'm going to give it a few minutes as people get logged on, and then we'll get started. Okay, we'll go ahead and get started, as I'm sure people will continue to log on as they get free and clear into the lunch hour. Thank you everybody for being with us here today. My name is Ryan Skrabarczyk. If we haven't met before, I'm the Director of Legislative and Regulatory Affairs for TNLA, and very proud to be in this position to serve as a manager and organizer of our advocacy efforts on behalf of this great industry. We have with us today Daniel Becca. He is the principal of Integrated Advocacy Solutions, and he actually is working with and for TNLA this year. We have a relationship with an organization called Forward.us that has TNLA was the grant recipient of, and it has enabled us to what we hope is a very aggressive grassroots advocacy campaign this fall, where we'll be working primarily on our two big labor issues under the overarching tent of H-2B and H-2A reform. As many of y'all are aware, these have been our biggest issues for a long time, and we're hopeful that this kind of renewed effort and really focused advocacy helps us move the needle. So Daniel has a presentation. He's going to kind of walk us through. His expertise is obviously in grassroots organizing. And the design and goal of today's webinar is to really set the stage for what we hope to be doing throughout the rest of this calendar year. And obviously, there's a lot going on in DC right now, and it takes a concerted effort to be heard amongst and over the fray. So I do want a couple of housekeeping points. If you feel free to use the chat if you'd like to. If you do have Q&A, pop a question into the Q&A bubble. You'll see it at the bottom of your panel there. And that way we'll know that it's a question that we need to get an answer to, whether in writing or we'll answer it in real time. We'll try to take up questions as we go through the presentation. So certainly don't feel obligated to hold a question towards the end. And we also want to thank our partner Hotchkiss Insurance, who has partnered with us for so long on our webinar series, and all that they do for our industry and helping us put on this type of education in a virtual format. So one quick favor, if I could beg it of everybody, the TNLA team is actually headed to Washington, D.C. next week. And one of the things that is going to be a major priority for us is going to be talking about disaster relief in the wake of Winter Storm Uri. So I know many of our companies, member companies, were hit in one way or another, to a greater or lesser extent. And you'll see an e-blast go out about this tomorrow. But we are going to ask that companies who were impacted, please send us a short testimonial of how your company was impacted. Detail for us the loss and just some of the costs that were associated with probably cleanup and or prep of the site during Winter Storm Uri. And if you can, please include images. We feel like if we are able to walk into offices next week and have a way to illustrate the impact of that event on our industry, we're going to be much more successful at driving down disaster relief for our member companies. So you can email that to sarah@tnlaonline.org, or you can email it to myself at ryan@tnlaonline.org, and we'll include those emails later in the chat for you to send those to. All right, without further ado, I'll go ahead and introduce Daniel and let him get started. This is a little bit about me and my background. I have hopefully met most of y'all, whether it's been at a TNLA event or an education event like this, or hopefully at Expo. But I do have a background in the state legislature. I worked for 6 years there and have been here at TNLA for another 3 years. And my role is kind of multifaceted in the fact that we work on both a federal and state level. We lobby directly the state legislature and state agencies, and we conduct all of our grassroots efforts to contact policymakers at a federal and state level. So I'm your guy on the inside. I am the lobbyist for our member companies, and I hope y'all won't hesitate to reach out if your business needs something, because ultimately that's what TNLA is here for, to make sure y'all are a success.
Hey folks, I'm Daniel Becca. As Ryan mentioned, I am principal at Integrated Advocacy Solutions. Our role at Integrated Advocacy is really to get people engaged in the process, and that process being the political and kind of decision-making process, the policy process on both the state and the federal level. Very excited to be working with TNLA on a number of federal issues, and very excited to be speaking with you all here today. So thank you first and foremost for coming and for participating. Showing up is certainly most of the battle, especially in this arena, and we'll talk a little bit more about that today. So just to give you kind of a sense of what to expect today, we're going to cover a little bit about the government process and what points in that process, in which points in that process you can have an impact. We're also going to talk about why specifically constituents matter, why you matter in this process. We'll then shift and talk a little bit about how we advocate successfully. We'll also cover policy and why it matters really to your business. And that really kind of gets at the crux of what we're speaking about today, is your business and the impact that the decision-making process and the policy process has on your business. And then we'll also talk a little bit about actions that you can take today that will help engage your business and further your business and advance TNLA policy priorities. Really hope that you walk away from this meeting. I think it will be a success if you're walking away with an understanding of why you need to and where to do so, and then how to engage in that political process, in that policymaking process. I think it'll also help give you a sense of connection and importance to your business. This advocacy work is complicated, policy work is complicated, but it is very connected to your business, and I think you'll see that today. And then I also hope that you walk away with a general level of comfort and interest to continue to engage in policy conversations for your business. As we go through the meeting, please put your questions in the chat and post those there. We will try to answer questions as we go along, and then we'll also have a Q&A section at the end for anybody who didn't get their question answered in the chat. So please do just put those in there. This session is also being recorded, so you can go back to any pieces that you may miss. You may also be able to share it with folks. But I wanted to kind of get us started out here with a quick poll and just asking whether or not you view yourself as an advocate for the industry. That poll should have popped up for you now. Go ahead and click that. We'll leave that open for a few minutes and let me know if you view yourself as an advocate for the industry. We'll move on to our next kind of first section here. And what we're looking at is the government process and kind of our advocacy opportunities around that. How many of you, this is not an official poll here, but how many of you remember Schoolhouse Rock and the I'm Just a Bill video? So we're going to turn now and we're going to watch that bit. No. We're not going to watch that video. This is not Schoolhouse Rock and we're not doing that. This is just a way to really kind of give folks a refresher and set the stage for talking about where we actually engage in advocacy and what that process looks like. So our first look at this, just a reminder about state and federal responsibilities, primarily responsibilities for the state and the federal government, of which TNLA and you as TNLA members all focus in, is the budget for both the state legislature and the federal government. Primarily, the budget is the main issue that everybody focuses on. However, both the federal government and the state legislature do have policy purview that really does impact your business. And Ryan is actually going to talk a little bit more about those policies a little bit later on. The makeup of the Texas legislature is here. I just wanted to give an understanding of exactly what we're talking about when we're looking at all advocating to all members of the legislature. You can see here, this bicameral system has essentially 181 members of the Texas legislature who need to be advocated to, who need to understand TNLA policies and TNLA issues. It's a lot of folks. They cover the entire state. So that's a lot of people to really convince and to share your story with. Moving on to the federal side, just a look at Congress. You can see the Texas delegation here with 36 members, but a lot more folks in Congress. I mean, obviously they cover the whole nation, but just to give you a sense of kind of the scope and what that looks like. We have two Texas senators, as you know, in Congress, in the U.S. Senate. We have Ted Cruz and John Cornyn, our Texas senators. Moving on kind of to our next point here, I wanted to give you a sense of the process and just a reminder of the process. The point here is not necessarily that you understand all of the details about this process. So this is a look at Congress and how a bill goes through Congress. What I want to really show you is actually where you can participate in this process, where advocates participate in this process. You have a great GR team, and that's what the folks at TNLA do for you, is track this process and track legislation and policy throughout this process and making sure that you really have, you're up to speed, you're engaged at the right points at the right time. But just to kind of take a look at some of those points in time, right before a bill is introduced is an opportunity to advocate for your issue. And then before a bill has a hearing is another opportunity. Maybe even during that hearing, it's an opportunity. And then before the bill goes to the floor and is prepared for a floor debate, getting in front of members to talk about your issue at that time is another really important place to do that. And moving through as the bill kind of moves through those initial steps of the process, you get it moves from one chamber to another, and you get to do it all again. So you get to go back through the committee process and back through the floor debate and all of that kind of thing in another chamber. So you get to do it all again. Then maybe the bill goes to conference and you have an opportunity before that to engage as well. And then before the final vote, engaging and talking with members again is a great opportunity. So moving on to the state system, in kind of what we have. It is very similar to what we have here in what we just looked at in the federal, to what we just looked at on the federal side, very similar. And again, what we're focused on here is not all of the other opportunities that your GR professionals at Ryan engages in those processes. What we're really focused on is about getting you people from the industry engaged in the process. And so these are the points at which we do that. Prior to a bill, introduction, creating the bill, during committee hearings, again, before floor activity, prior to members going, taking a vote on the floor. And then again, we do it all again there in the House or the Senate, whichever bill the chamber goes to next. There are lots of other opportunities outside of this process. This is not the only advocacy engagement that we see. There's many things going on the state legislative side during an interim when members are back home in their districts. That's the most important time to engage. What we're talking about here and what I'm showing you is just a look inside the legislative process and where we may engage. Ryan? And
if I could also add to that, I think there's two things that we want to help communicate here. When you see multiple messages from TNLA, for example, and you're thinking, well, I already sent a message, or I already sent an email, or spoke to somebody about that bill earlier in the process. Note that at each one of these points, and part of the reason why Daniel's identifying them, is our messaging may alter as a piece of legislation moves through the process. And so we want to make sure that the messages being received by the offices and the ultimately the decision that they make at each juncture reflects what we're communicating to them. And so if you see it, us ask you to do something multiple times and it's on an issue you've already, you feel like you've engaged on, there's probably a reason, and we will try to distinguish why that is different from the last time you were asked to engage. But please always give real due consideration, and especially if it's something through our Legislative Action Center. Folks, it takes a click of a button. You enter your information, you click and send the pre-written message, or you can even adopt it to your own. And we're going to talk a little bit about that in a second. But you know, that just that small effort really does accumulate, especially when we're talking about something at the congressional level. And then secondly, before you move on, Daniel, I think one of the important parts is not only is each one of the junctures you're illustrating here important for passing a bill and where we can engage, it's also that's every step we can kill a bill, right? Every piece of legislation that we don't like, or every piece of legislation that would negatively impact our industry, those are our opportunities to really engage and really kind of try to overwhelm that process with negative or opposition messaging, so that it is made clear that at least our industry is significantly opposed. And we'll always try to explain the reasons why. But so I just think that, you know, it may look like kind of the schoolhouse rock and you think, well, I did it once and I did it at the very beginning, so my congressman ought to know exactly where I'm at. The messaging changes, the process changes. Bills, as you're probably aware of, get smashed into and added on to other ones, and some of them get hung like Christmas trees. I mean, it's just how the legislative process at the federal and state level work. So engaging multiple times may be necessary. And we kind of ask you to just go along with us on that ride and that journey with us.
Yeah, I think that those are all great points, Brian. And I think one of the most important things to remember there, in addition to that, is that and we'll talk about it a little bit as well, is that if you are not speaking up at these inflection points, at these opportunities, nobody else will be for your industry. It is you. And what that means is that the decision makers won't be getting information relevant to your industry, your side of the story, as they're making these decisions and considering these policies. So what really does motivate decision makers? Wanted to take a look here at some of the specific factors that move folks along in their decision-making process. Colleagues are an incredibly important one. Partisan politics, you've all certainly seen and know about, is important, actually. Party is important to decision makers, and that certainly is a motivating factor. Polling is another really important one. elected officials like to see where certain groups or certain types of people stand on the issues. And so they're constantly getting their hands on as much polling information as they possibly can for various issues. Media is super important to decision makers. What they cover, what they're saying about a particular policy, and what they're saying about a particular elected official. Those are all influential factors in a decision maker's mind as they're moving through that process. Legislators are people. Just like you and I, they put their they put their socks on and go out and go through their day. But they are paying attention to whatever news channel they happen to be watching or whatever radio show they happen to listen to on their drive to work. They are just like us in that regard. And so it's important what the media is saying, and that's why a lot of members of the legislature certainly do pay attention to that. They also do pay attention to facts and figures. What's most important here is not just any facts and figures. Members of elected officials tend to be very read heavy. They tend to want to know direct impacts of particular issues on their district. And so you have a real role to play in providing those facts and figures and direct impacts, specifically because you are the individuals who are most impacted by that and have the best story to tell. And so we'll talk a little bit about that as well. Lastly, next is staff. Staff of legislators or members of Congress are the policy professionals. These folks are often the people that you meet with. They may be anywhere between the ages of 22 and 60. They run the gamut, but they are the policy professionals. And whether they're just starting out, whether they have been there a long time, the most important thing to remember about staff is that these are the folks who, one, know the policy in and out, two, also have the most direct influence on decisions on the decisions that legislators are making kind of in the moment. When an elected official comes into an office and is getting ready to prepare for a hearing or a floor vote, they go directly to the staff member who is working on that issue and ask for the information that they need to prepare themselves to get in and ready for that. So meeting with and discussing and working with staff, building relationships with staff is very important. Constituents, you, voters, people in the district for which the elected official is from are incredibly important. We'll talk about this a little bit, but legislators and members of Congress do listen to their constituents. Why? Well, they care. They care for lots of different reasons what their constituents have to say. But some of them really do care about the well-being of their community, of their districts. Really, I'm not joking about that. They do. And it is a real sentiment. They care about their districts. They're genuine people. But they also care about re-election. And constituents tend to be the folks who vote for members of the legislature or members of Congress. And so they care about re-election. They care about their image. And so that means they care about what you think. So we're going to take a little bit of a look at some of the most persuasive tactics and approaches to advocacy and what kind of really works with engaging with legislators. Two things are really important to them. Personal connection, and this is their own personal connection to an issue, and then constituent interest, your personal connection to an to a particular issue. It's really important to provide input. As I mentioned before, members of the legislature or members of Congress, they are not going to understand your issue if you aren't telling them your side of the story. They're just going to go into their decision-making process with whatever information they have already kind of in their coffers and have collected from their staff or their own personal perception. So it's really important that you provide them with the most relevant information in your personal story that you can. How do we know this is effective? Well, actually, there was a study done in 2015 by the Congressional Management Foundation in which they really gave us a great glimpse at how legislators, elected officials, and staff take in all of the input. If you look, kind of initially on the left side of this screen, you see that your input really does matter. So what we're talking about here, 94% of congressional staff believe that in-person visits from constituents have influence over a member. 92% said that individualized email messages have influence over a member. These are important pieces of information. And what they tell us is that the engagement that you have the opportunity for as a constituent is unique in terms of influence in getting the attention of members of Congress. So where do they get this information? What are the tactics? What are the opportunities for this input? How do they gather it? Look over here at this chart, and we can see not only how they gather it, but what the most influential pieces are. Meetings between staff and constituents, number one. Communications from your representatives or district-based groups. So we're talking local folks is number two. Again, attending events in the district. So this is where members of Congress or the legislature go and hear from constituents again. So all of these most important engagement tools and understanding tools are things that are in person. They're highly tactile. They're very engaging opportunities. And so they are, we again see where we really need to spend some of our time and to focus. Here, what we're taking a look at is, what are the actual tactics? What are the tools or actions that have the most influence? What are the things that you can do as a constituent that have the most impact? This is a great chart that kind of gives us a sense of what tools or actions are highly important. Now, if you look down here, you can see that some are less influential than others, but the point is not that that some are less or more influential than others. They all work differently at different points in time. All of these items have influence. All of these actions have influence. So I don't think that, for example, a form email, you may say, doesn't have a lot of influence. Well, actually, it does. It has 56% of a positive impact. And, at times when timing is very important, things are moving very quickly through the process, quick action is needed, and you don't have time to schedule a fly-in and go visit a member of Congress in their office, a form email, and that positive influence, just so a member of Congress has, or a member of the legislature has, the ability to hear from their constituents on a particular issue, could be exactly the type of influence that you need. The other thing that I'll point out here when we're talking about individual, or when we're talking about email messages, is form email messages are here at 56% of a positive influence. So very positive, but you move that up to an individualized email message and we're looking all of a sudden at 92% of an influencing factor here. And that I think is very, very important. We'll talk a little bit about more about that in just a few minutes when we talk about some of the more specific stuff. Ryan, did you have something to add there?
Yeah, I just wanted to back up what you were saying on the last slide about many of the messages that come from our Legislative Action Center are form emails, but you can individualize them. That's going to be a key takeaway from this going forward is everything that Daniel has set up to this point should be telling you the greater you can personalize something to the congresswoman or man's district, personalize it to the impact on your individual business or the local economy, the more effective your message is going to be. And the slide prior to that, in the in weighting the value of what was going to be the most effective at swaying an office, I think we need to contemplate as folks in the green industry, when an issue is very important to us, it probably and almost always means we need to take an additional step beyond sending it. Right. There's your congressman or woman has a district office that is in your community, more than likely. or there's one nearby. Scheduling an appointment and talking with that staff member who has that direct line to the member of Congress can be critically important. But if you don't have the time for that, picking up the phone and leaving a message is that much more effective than sending the email. Now, they're all important, like Daniel said, and that forum email sets that kind of base or foundation for the policymaker to understand, okay, this is the general sense that I'm getting from my district. And it's certainly empowering when we can show up in large numbers with that, in especially in the case where we might have opposition on the other side. If you can outnumber your opposition by just simply the flow of the amount of messages headed into that office, we're gonna see success. We're gonna move the needle, you know. And then there are other options you can take as an individual to kind of step up that that way. And we'll talk. I think Daniel's going to talk in a little bit about kind of how the best way to handle those.
Yeah. So, real quick, before we kind of talk through this slide a little bit, wanted to run just another poll. And ask you if you have actually used any of these methods to contact your elected officials. So go ahead, that poll should have popped up. Go ahead and start to populate that. And we'll take a look at those results here in just a little bit. As you're doing that poll, I want to turn your attention back to our slide here. And really what we're looking at here are it talks exactly to what Ryan was just saying with regards to personalized messages. And so when we're thinking about communicating with members of Congress, members of the legislature, this is a great guide for us to understand and see what are the most important things that we need to do in those communications to make sure that we are having the most impact possible. We look at the top. It's information or impact about the bill. This is local impact. Members want to know how it impacts their constituents, their community, and that is something that you can convey. Next, clear intentions. We want to make sure that the ask or that the reasons for supporting or not supporting a bill are very clear. Often, members will go ask for specific policy adjustments based on how constituents are feeling, and you may have a specific ask for that, which takes us to our next important or very helpful point here, and that is a timely, clear ask or request to be associated with your contact when you're talking to a member about a particular issue. And then lastly, very important information is how, again, you relate back to that particular bill. So we're talking about relevance to you as a person, to your business, as an economic driver in the district or in the state. Those are important things to mention. So now I want to take a look at kind of the tactics and the structure and how we actually advocate. It really hinges on kind of a simple principle and kind of what we do, how we start to implore all of those tactics that we just talked about and just saw were actually influential with constituents. How do we implore that and kind of where do we implore that? I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but I wanted to just give you a sense of the bigger picture of advocacy and kind of what we're doing. So you know that it's not just the one email that you're getting asking for a click of a button to send that quick email. There's a much bigger plan. There's a much bigger engagement for advocacy than what you might think. But the three different principles are organize, inform, and engage. We do these different things each in kind of their own circle, and then we pull them all together to string together a full advocacy program. The most important part of that is actually understanding both who and where we're doing these things. We're organizing, informing, and engaging. The who is, very simple. There are really three different places, three different groups that we focus on, that TNLA is focused on in advocacy. One is TNLA. It's your membership. It's you as constituents engaging, staying updated, receiving talking points, and then sharing information on the issue. That's just as important as any of the other three groups that we're trying to influence. Legislators is incredibly important. You do that through constituent connection, your GR team, your governmental relations team, and directly through the issues that you're working on. They have to be relevant issues to members of the legislature or members of Congress, and you have to show them why those things are important to them. And then lastly, Texans. This is another group that you really want to have influence, specifically because they're also voters and they're also in that local community. And so that's a group that we think about engaging. The most important thing that you can do to engage Texans and to support this group is sharing information about your business, about your industry with members of your community, sharing why it's important and why these policy things are important to your business and to the community. Where do we do these? We do these in three different places: political, legislative, and public. We have the political engagement, campaigns, elections. We'll talk about PAC giving a little bit. And then, you know, state and federal level, as we have talked about, there's also the local level to engage on, but primarily TNLA is focused on the state and federal levels. And then again, in the public sphere and in the public arena, both in the state and kind of the local community, and how your business impacts both of those things are very, very important to this issue. Again, pulling the organize, inform, and engage circles along with us. We structure advocacy in a couple of different ways as well. You can see we have brass tops engagement, we have grass tops engagement, and we have grassroots engagement. These essentially are just different levels of category that we put individuals in based on their engagement levels. Brass tops folks may be doing a little bit different things than the grassroots folks. But these again are based on your engagement levels in politics and policy and in TNLA. So this is just kind of how we structure it. But all three of these different categories of advocates are focused on the same thing. It's being local, it's cultivating relationships with other industry partners, and also with members of Congress, their staff, and legislators, state legislators and their staff. It's about having open and consistent communication. So not just coming to the rescue when you have a fire, it's about being consistent. It's about being open with your preferences, with your policy needs, and consistently communicating those things. And then it's also about relevant experiences. So bringing, again, your experiences to the table.
Daniel, if I could on that last slide as well, I think that if you are wondering where you fall in that pyramid, it really is your choice, essentially. You know, and I think it depends on, again, your comfort level with where you are in advocating on behalf of our industry. But certainly everyone should be involved in our grassroots efforts, right? That's the minimum that you can do in order to communicate. It's our mass efforts. It's when we push out email blasts and ask people to send in those messages. And from there, you really can opt in to go up that chain of command, I guess, if you want to consider it that. You can buy into being the grass tops or in the brass tops. And I think the distinguishing factor there is that the very top of that pyramid are going to be individuals that are politically motivated, probably get involved in local campaigns. And so elected officials will know them by that, by your political advocacy. Maybe you donate directly to political campaigns. Maybe you're involved with a PAC, hopefully TNLA's PAC, and those type of things. So if you're a business owner, for example, and you should automatically be in one of the upper tiers because you have control of that larger economic view of how decisions are impacting the business, right? How many employees you can keep on, the fact that you probably want to grow your business and not shrink it. And so your feedback to policymakers weighs that much more because that larger economic impact, you can communicate that. And so, you know, if you want to, and you should, get all of your employees, though, involved in our grassroots effort, right? Everyone, when we send out an alert through the Legislative Action Center, send it on to your employees, or at least the management, the sales team, the your foreman, anybody who maybe has that kind of broader perspective of how helping the industry does truly help them individually. And through that, we can magnify our efforts.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, so let's talk a little bit about what you can do with organize, inform, and engage now that you kind of know a little bit more about that structure and kind of the bigger picture. The intent is to not have you be thinking about that structure and how those things are put together. Be thinking about these types of things. So, start early and organizing yourselves. And like Ryan was saying, bringing your employees in, getting folks trained, start early. Thinking of existing relationships, are you at events with state legislators or members of Congress, or do your kids play soccer together? Are they around in engagements and opportunities that you have? Do you have a buddy who happens to know them? Those types of things are very important. So if you have those relationships, let Ryan know. That's a really important thing to do. And then look for partners. Internal, external partners, other folks who have overlapping issues that align with the issues that you care about. Always be looking for partners. And as you discover those, really do bring those along to TNLA and make sure that folks know that there's an engagement opportunity for a potential partner. Inform, really, this is about staying up to date, knowing your business, and developing your story. Know how the particular policy priorities impact you and impact your business and how your business impacts the state. TNLA will give you lots of tools and facts and information to be able to put all those pieces together, but it's really you who has the story to put to the particular policy and share with decision makers. So really know your business and know how your story relates to the particular policy that you're discussing. And then share with others. Don't just keep it to yourself. It doesn't matter whether you're sharing with your employees, internal staff, your colleagues, other business owners, business owners outside of your industry. If you're at a barbecue with folks, sharing how important your business is in the community is an important thing that you can do, and you can do it really casually. It doesn't have to be a formal engagement. Lastly is the TNLA Action Center. And we're going to talk a little bit about the TNLA Action Center. But first, let's take a quick look at some of the asks that you may have from TNLA with the Action Center. First and foremost, we have emails coming in. We talked about those emails a little bit. Phone calls directly to members of the legislature, in-person or virtual meetings, local events with elected officials, and then again in elections. And that means giving to candidates, that means voting, that means participating in the PAC, the TNLA PAC on the state level. Those are all very, very important. In-person or virtual meetings, these are the most powerful. But they also take a little bit more work. Virtual meetings are pretty easy. It's just on your computer. But in-person meetings, you have to come down here to Austin and visit with somebody. You have to go to a district office and visit with them there. Or you have to go to DC and visit with them there. Those are all great opportunities, and they're very, very powerful. So to the extent that you can participate in those, really encourage you to do so. Ryan, do you have the results of that poll that we took earlier? This would be a good place to just kind of see how folks have participated before. I don't know if you can share that thing and throw it up there. There you go. Good. So, we see quite a few folks, have engaged in emails, quite a few folks in phone calls, and then also, some folks participating in in-person visits. I think ideally, we want to get to a point those meetings and those in-person engagements highly participated in. So we'll talk now a little bit about the TNLA Action Center. Here is the homepage of the TNLA Action Center You can see that. I just wanted to give you a glimpse of it. It sounds like many of you have already been here, but this is what you can expect to see. You have campaigns that are relevant and timely that Ryan has put up there. The option for you to sign up for alerts if you're not already receiving those. I really encourage you to do that. We will have a follow-up email that comes out after this training that provides the link for you to go ahead and sign up and register for those, as well as some information about finding your elected official and tracking specific legislation. So those are all important elements of that homepage, but where we really get to kind of the key to advocacy engagement is here on the Action Center. Ryan mentioned it earlier in terms of personalization and email personalization, but this is just a way to see where you can do that. Many times you can adjust the subject of your email and then your message body. So your first message here is pre-loaded text from TNLA that has relevant information, policy information, the specific ask for the member of the legislature or member of Congress that you're engaging with. And you can come right in here, would be my suggestion. If you don't wanna mess with the policy stuff in this email, come right in here at the top and say, I'm a constituent, I live in this town and in your district, and I own a business that has this many people in it, and I care about this policy because. And that would be a really simple and easy way to just throw a sentence in there that personalizes this message and maybe gets a little bit more attention than just the form message would. So that is what that looks like. Again, form messages, 56%, but individualized messages increase influence, 92%. So something really to think about. Again, this all really does go back to sharing your story, telling your story. You're the expert here. These folks don't live in your world. They don't know your business. They don't know your issues. And the only way they're going to learn that is directly from you. So I really encourage you to start to participate in these efforts to, and bring others along to participate in these efforts to make sure that your story is getting told. I think that that is one of the most important things that you can do is bring others along to participate with you. Just real quick, if you have already participated in a legislative meeting, so we're talking about a virtual meeting or an in-person meeting, this is kind of what it looks like. Typical meeting, I'm not going to run through the details. Often these meetings are with staff. They are discussion-based, and there's always a briefing prior to the meeting. So TNLA is not just going to throw you into a meeting with a member of the legislature or Congress without making sure that you're comfortable with the material, that you're comfortable with the policy, and that you know the other group members and the other folks who are participating in the meeting, and you have some time to kind of map that out. So there's a briefing beforehand. And these meeting outlines could really be, this could apply to a federal fly-in. This could apply to coming down here to the State House in Austin, or this could be a virtual engagement and a virtual meeting. I will again stress the importance of staff. A lot of folks are discouraged when they go to a meeting and they're only meeting with a 22-year-old staffer, and it doesn't really seem like they're that experienced. Those folks really are the policy experts. And if they don't know much about your issue because they're new to it, believe me, they are going to learn about your issue because that's their job. Their job is to relay your issue to the elected official. And so those folks are very important to engage with, to cultivate relationships with, and to make sure they have the information.
I'll just add to that, and I say this also being a former staffer in a elected official's office, it's why TNLA spends such an enormous time trying to cultivate and maintain relationships with staff, certainly key staff, because often, as Daniel said, that's the quickest way to have that communicated to the policymaker. But if we're not communicating it to that staff member, I can guarantee you your opposition is, right? And you can almost be certain of that on every single issue. That's why it's so important for us to engage and engage in a significant volume, because Daniel's right. Even in a situation where you walk into a meeting and you think this person's like right out of college, they don't seem to know a lot about our issue. They don't seem to know a lot about H2B or H2A or whatever the issue may be. They will learn, and they're going to learn quickly. And so I think you have to consider for yourself, who would you rather they learn from? You and your perspective and our perspective as an industry, or another group that's going to come in and tell them what they think they know about the issue. And so that's really why it's important for us. And so, you know, don't ever be discouraged by the fact that we're meeting with staff. And like I said, all of these elected officials, they have district offices in your community, which means they have district staff that work in those offices. They probably attend chamber events. They probably attend, you know, town halls, a whole litany of things that go on in your community. If you have an opportunity, if say something is just going on with your business and you communicate that, or maybe just individually, you know, certainly with a lot of the pandemic related stuff, you may have had that opportunity. Communicate that to that staffer. Try to keep up a relationship with them, because that will pay dividends for your business and certainly our industry later when we do have that ask that comes along of, hey, we need their boss to do this.
That's exactly right. So now, you know, just a quick time check. We've got about 9 minutes or so to get through the rest of this, but we really wanted to give you a sense of how advocacy is relevant to your business and discuss some of the policy priorities of TNLA and of your business. And so this is really, I think, probably the most important thing to take away today is just how important your participation in these issues is, and just how important these issues can be to your business. And so I'll turn it over to Ryan to run through the TNLA policy priorities and some base information here.
Sure. So we do want to share, obviously, our economic impact of the industry. It should go without saying that one of the things that policymakers care so much about are the ability to make appropriations. They can't make those appropriations if they're not collecting tax revenue, and our tax revenue comes from the economic engine of business. And so the economic impact of just our industry alone is significant in the state of Texas. And we share almost always in this format with updates as we, as Charlie Hall and Marco Palma at Texas A&M, update that information. So we'll always be sharing that. But I mean, take away the fact that that top line number is significant, and the number of jobs we have and the number of businesses that are related or depend in some way on our industry, all very important to policymakers. You can go to the next slide. I'll run through this very quickly. These are just our general policy statements or priorities that we put out there, especially when we're making a first time meeting with a legislator who may be newly elected or in a new committee position or have new staff. But certainly labor and workforce development almost always going to be our number one lead issue, because it has been for so long, and it's only been made worse, frankly, by what's going on with COVID and the pandemic. Property rights, from both a individual homeowner's perspective and their ability to make plant choices and, you know, develop their home the way they would like, as well as growers and the investments that you have to make and have as a grower to produce the plants for the green industry. Inspection and disease management from TDA, we need them to have the resources to keep our industry strong and in a sensible and reasonable and hopefully business-friendly manner. Water development and restrictions. TNLA is a big advocate of developing additional water resources, because we know in a drought scenario, we're always going to be the first ones that are going to be impacted. So the better, more secure, more reliable our water resources are for our various communities, we hope to lessen those impacts. And also, if we can develop new resources in that arena, that will enable consumers to have more plant options and plant choices in their community. Transportation infrastructure, and you could almost tie that with things like trucking and freight, all very important, obviously, to move our products around the state and make it from, you know, throughout the entire supply chain. And then just generally business and agriculture, we want to have a friendly, predictable regulatory environment, something that's constantly changing, that is not easy on anybody, and ultimately creates costs. So we want to make sure our taxes, our fees, and everything are fairly consistent and take any unpredictability out of that, take out as much patchwork regulation as possible so that way we have consistency across the area. And you can go to the next slide. So what are we working on right now? This is just federally. So obviously the state legislature has, they go in on January of every odd year and they meet for a brief period of time, really. And so for the other year and a half of their term, they're in the interim unless the governor calls special sessions, which he has been doing recently. But as we speak, they're not in Austin making new laws. They will be returning next week to do things like redistricting. But what are we working on federally? H-2B Returning Worker Exception Act by actually Texas Congressman Henry Cuellar. It is a standalone piece of legislation that would provide permanent cap relief for H-2B. It is a major priority of ours. We're not sure whether that bill will move forward in as a standalone bill, or do we have the opportunity in this larger immigration conversation to put returning worker exemptions or some type of cap relief in that policy and make sure that looking at next year and the years beyond, we have a little bit more reliability in the H-2B program. Far too many Texas companies have been capped out through there, and we want to stop that. Farm Workforce Modernization Act is a major policy that has already passed the House and is in the Senate. It's been batted around a couple of times, but significant for our industry in that bill is a reduction in cost and the expense and the just the general compliance with the H-2A program. Basically the sister program for growers and so important for that other part of our industry and supply chain. Luckily, H-2A is not capped. However, it's incredibly burdensome and costly. And, you know, often employers undertake it only because they can't find workforce. We know that to be true pretty consistently across the state. And so we'd like to improve that program if we can. One of the things, as I mentioned, we'll be working on next week and throughout the rest of the fall and into the calendar year is Winter Storm Uri disaster relief. We have got to get some kind of relief program set up for what happened in February. And I know you're thinking, it's already September. Why has it taken so long? And that's just, frankly, folks, the speed of government. But we have a key opportunity starting this next week as Congress returns to full business mode to try to make that happen. And then some farm tax issues. You might be aware a major spending bill is working its way through the process. And we just want to make sure that we're cognizant and aware of some of the ways that Congress plans to pay for that spending bill. That is a very fluid situation. I sent out an email this morning on the TNLA leader list. And if you're not on the leader list, go to tnlaonline.org, go to advocacy and subscribe to that leader list and we'll get you added to the listserv. We send those updates out infrequently through the interim as issues and updates need to be put out. And it's really for that group that kind of self-selects into, I want to be really involved. I want to understand more so of the political and government things that are going on affecting our industry. So we'll try to update the leader list as much as possible with that tax situation as it happens. I think that's it on that.
Okay, thanks, Ryan. So just some key takeaways from today's training in the few minutes that we've got left. One, this process is complex, the issues are complex, but you have TNLA to get you plugged in with the right information at the right time. Lots of resources there on tnlaonline.org, as Ryan mentioned. And so I really encourage you to go and check those out. Most importantly, constituents matter. You matter in this process. Your story is key and has a significant impact on the decisions that elected officials are making. So prepare your story, think about it, and then get ready to share it and take advantage of the opportunities that you do have to share it. The advocacy has many, many different shapes and there are many different activities that take place in it. But they're all important at the right time and in the right place. And you have lots of opportunity to just click a button and easily engage in advocacy and support not only TNLA and your industry at large, but your specific business and the policy decisions that are being made about your specific business. So again, encourage you to stay up to date on information coming from TNLA that impacts your business. And lastly here, just wanted to give you a few final takeaways. What can you leave this training right now and go and do to advocate? First and foremost, if you're not, register to vote and then get out and actually vote. You're a constituent. If you're not registered and you go in to meet with an elected official, a member of Congress often, they will certainly look at voter rolls and see whether or not you're registered and whether or not you actually could vote for them. It's just an important way not only to show that you're engaged in the process, but actually to make a difference and help elect folks who adhere to your policy priorities and things that are important to you in the process. Follow TNLA and your elected officials on social media. If you are not following your elected officials on social media, go for it. Just go over, give them a follow. And a way to engage with them simply is just to like certain things that they post if they happen to be relevant to your policy priority. And so that's a great thing to be able to do to kind of keep up with elected officials and understand exactly where they are coming from on particular issues and engage with them there. Send your elected official or the staff in your elected official's office, their district office, a brief personal email. Just reach out. It doesn't have to be anything more than, hey, I own a business here in the district, or I work for this business here in the district. We do X, Y, and Z. And I just wanted to say hi and introduce myself. Often, TNLA is going to come back to you with opportunities to engage with that office. If you are a familiar name because you had reached out before, that's going to be that's going to kind of give you a leg up in that meeting. And it's a great way to simply engage with these offices. Again, they really, as we showed kind of earlier, they really do want to engage with decision makers, with constituents. They really do want to hear from you. And if you're reaching out to them to introduce yourself, that's a great step in the process. Sign up again for TNLA Advocacy Alerts. Contribute to the TNLA PAC. You can do that right there on the TNLA website. A very important way to continue to grow your constituent influence in the elected process. And then lastly, schedule a local TNLA engaged training. So one of the things that is very important is to help as many TNLA members or affiliates, employees of TNLA member businesses engage in this process. The more folks that you have engaging in this process, the stronger your industry is going to be on these policy matters. And so it's critical that you continue to share this information and then we get as many folks trained and ready to prepare as possible. The last poll we had was just a quick poll, Ryan, to just gauge comfort. If you're comfortable engaging and participating in the process, that poll should have popped up. Go ahead and fill that out. We'd love to hear it. If you're not, that's fine too. But just let us know. And then at this point, we can open it up to questions, Ryan. I hadn't been following along, but I imagine there may be a question or two over in the chat.
Yeah, we don't have any at the moment. So I know folks are kind of coming up on the end of the lunch hour. If you do have a question, feel free to send it into the chat. We're getting a couple of responses. A majority of people do feel comfortable. Some people feel somewhat comfortable. So nobody said no yet, which is good because we're certainly going to lean on the folks who participated in today's webinar and your colleagues to act on behalf of our industry and help all of us be more successful in that effort.
Yeah. And for anybody who is thinking, yeah, I'm still not really comfortable with this advocacy thing, let me assure you that TNLA is well positioned to make sure that you're prepared to participate in this process. And that we want you to be successful in your advocacy efforts because it does help the entire TNLA family be successful in advocacy policy and advocacy and policy priorities. And so they have the right structure and the right setup to make sure that you are going to be successful in participating in advocacy activity.
All right. Well, if there are no questions, we'll certainly let everyone get back to their day. Thank you so much. And I will send out one more plea for just information. If you feel like you were particularly impacted by Winter Storm Uri, please do send any information along to Sarah or I so it can be compiled prior to TNLA going to Washington, D.C. Next week. There will be additional opportunities throughout the end of this year and even the early part of next year to go to D.C. So if that's something you may be interested in, include that too and let us know if you want to engage in that manner. We're going to be doing some virtual meetings throughout the state of Texas. We're going to be conducting a few congressional roundtables. We will be doing all kinds of manner of outreach. And in the next legislative session, there's going to be a TNLA legislative day. So keep all of these things in mind. We greatly appreciate your time and your willingness to help our industry and help your business. And please know that we're here to be a resource for you. So we'll go ahead and sign off and thank you, everyone. And we'll look forward to seeing you on our next webinar.